APAC, the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, approves a $750 million loan to the Philippines to help it cope with the effects of the pandemic. The lender said the loan, which amounts to nearly 38 billion pesos, is intended to increase the country's testing capacity, support vulnerable sectors, as well as provide aid to poor households. It will also benefit over 1 million small businesses. The project will be co-financed by the Asian Development Bank. Central bankers and regulators are pulling out all the stops, trying to shield the country's financial system from the fallout of COVID-19. The worry is that this massive public health crisis will turn into a credit crisis, with companies, including some banks, now withdrawing guidance, suspending dividends, and reworking strategies to reflect that grim reality. Joining us now, treasurer of the Yuchenko-led bank RCBC, the country's eighth largest based on assets, Ricky Cebrero. Hi, Ricky. Thanks for joining us.
Hi, good afternoon, Vivi.
Good afternoon. So the financial sector is looking at an erosion of loan growth, higher credit costs, as you guys prepare for a dramatic spike in bad debt from both retail and corporate borrowers. Could you give us, what is the sense in your bank today?
Well, I wouldn't call it as a dramatic spike. Definitely there's going to be an increase. That's why you have been reading in the newspapers this first quarter and the first quarter that the banks are preparing or setting aside provisions for a possible increase on bad debts due to the lockdown or the effects of the lockdown due to the C-19. Mm-hmm. Banks are well prepared. I think the banks are coming into this kind of economic scenario with a very strong balance sheet. We do have a lot of strong capital ratios. To begin with, the regulators did prepare us for this kind of situation, capital ratios of the bank to face this kind of situation is very, very strong. Mm-hmm. That's why we still continue, and we have, and I think the whole banking industry have prepared this first quarter by setting aside provisions in their books.
And when you look at the broader economy, though, how do you fathom, how do you model the kind of dislocation in jobs the unemployment of that scale will produce on consumption and ultimately your business?
Definitely, there's going to be an effect on consumption. We are a consumption-driven economy. But then again, we do think that the government will step in, and they have stepped in by the stimulus package that they have been introducing to further stimulate the growth of the economy. Consumer will be slower, definitely, in the coming months. But there's going to be a pickup, not the same pickup as we've seen for the past years or even early on this year. But slowly, it will pick up. There will be some sectors that will have a delayed pickup because, of course, like tourism, like air travel, you would not want to go out yet for now. Because you would want to plan maybe in the next 6 months, but there will be some sectors in the economy on the consumer side that would have a faster pickup growth compared to the other sectors. Mm-hmm.
And Ricky, given all of these expectations, do you think banks will be more inclined to be extra conservative in giving out loans? I imagine the problematic sectors would be MSMEs with very short runways, retail borrowers who take personal unsecured loans, who may be facing job losses now, and even microfinance institutions who have been giving small unsecured loans to daily wage earners who may not have the income today.
I don't believe that banks will be extra conservative. Mm. They will maintain its conservatism. They will do their due diligence. But the banks are there to provide stimulus to the economy. Our objective is to be in line with the government's efforts to stimulate the economy. We have done a lot of efforts. The banks have done a lot of things in order to ensure that we mitigate the effects, the negative effects of COVID-19, mm-hmm. Providing stimulus to the economy, looking at talking to our borrowers. We know that these are creditworthy accounts and they just have a little bit of a problem right now in terms of liquidity. Revenues are not coming in. And the fundamentals, the credit fundamentals of these accounts are still there, very strong. They just have a little bit of a problem in the very near term. Then what do we do? What kind of help do we give as banks? One thing that we do give, are giving and will be giving, will be extending the duration of the loans, mm-hmm. extending the prepayments, the payment principals, lengthening the duration, so that the principal payments or the amortizations of these businesses will be a little bit lower until we find a pickup on their revenue stream.
Mm-hmm. That's very encouraging. Before we move on to the game plan, Ricky, I'm very curious, what is your exposure to the badly hit aviation industry?
As far as the bank's concerned, we don't have.
Oh, okay, that's at least one good news. And what do you think of bad banks, so-called bad banks? Other countries did this right after the 2008 global financial crisis. Is it time to have our own bad banks?
No, in fact, let me go back as far back as before the GFC, the global financial crisis. The bad bank concept, I think, was very, very successful in the Asian financial crisis, 1997-98. But we are in a different situation now. As I said a while ago, the banks right now are in a better balance sheet position. We have our capital ratios very, very strong. But then again, having said that, a bad bank concept is not that bad at all. It basically divides the bad assets, the assets that you don't want from in your bank, and put it in another company or a vehicle, which could be managed differently from the good assets. The concept of having a bad bank will ensure the investors or stockholders that you are managing your core business properly. There will be more focus on managing your core business. Having this kind of concept is very good. There's nothing, I don't think there's anything wrong with it. But do we need it right now? We still don't know. I don't think so. Well, we haven't talked about it.
Ricky, big picture. RCBC had a pretty strong start to the year. Net income up 77%. Also in the first 5 months of the year, you did see ATM disbursements hit 2 billion pesos. What now? I mean, we're all bracing for tough times ahead. What's the game plan for RCBC?
Well, definitely the 77% that you saw in the first quarter will taper down towards the end of the year. Plus, of course, we have to review the growth that we're looking at because of certain constraints that has been brought into the equation. But we will continue to grow on areas that would specially expedite the jump-starting of economic activity in the country. We will further strengthen the digital platforms and partnerships with the private payout centers and the government for more efficient delivery of our financial services. We will engage our customers both on the borrowing and depositor side and further enhance customer experience in doing business via electronic way. We probably would review the branch physical branches as we have experienced for the past 2-3 months. The increase of usage of digital highway, we might see that there might be no need for additional physical branches. We will continue making prices in the market for fixed income bonds and foreign exchange being used for as benchmark for pricing certain contracts. And yes, all of this, we could continue to further strengthen.
Ricky, safe to assume that you guys will be on cash preservation mode. Perhaps you're going to be changing your dividend policy soon, suspending any plans for share buybacks for now?
In terms of cash preservation mode, definitely we also, well, at least for the bank, we did come into this situation with a very, very strong liquidity base. We continue to maintain our strong liquidity base. In terms of capital preservation, that's one of the objective of the banks. You do maintain capital or the proper usage of capital. You would like to get the best return on the capital. That is an ongoing thing for the banks.
And
in terms of the dividend policy, we continue to observe the dividend policy. We continue to observe the dividend policy.
Okay, and final question very quickly. We don't have much time. Is there anything more that the very aggressive Philippine Central Bank and other policymakers can do?
One thing that I believe in, and I guess most of the industry players in the financial industry would agree with me, the regulators are ahead of the curve. They did rate cuts, they did reserve cuts. They have a lot of ammunition. They have been saying this always, that they still have a lot of tools that they can begin. But the central bank, and we all have to wait for the effects of this, because there are lagging effects for this. The central bank, we are very, very confident that they have all the tools to address all things that's coming our way.
Okay. On that note, Ricky, thank you very much for joining us this afternoon. Good luck.
Thank you, Mimi.